joy to share my little experience in this August forum, and I sincerely thank the society for the opportunity given. So today I will be making a discussion on the application of few principles of inhalation anesthesia with little bit of illustrations, so that you can make or you can develop a safe, economically viable and eco-friendly inhalational anesthetic maintenance protocol that suits your requirement. So as a veterinarian, it is our ethical obligation to ensure that the patients subjected to painful interventions are pain-free. Naturally, the adequate dose of anesthesia ensures this. The discovery of anesthetics is considered as the second
Sir, please share your presentation again.
All are requested not to share their own presentation. Please listen to Dr. Senthil Kumar.
Yes, sir.
Shall I proceed, Divesh?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So the discovery of anesthetics is considered as the second top medical advances that has changed the world. So it has sidelined even the use of antibiotics, and the first medical advance goes to the vaccine. So the scope of inhalational anesthesia in large animal practice is expanding, and most of the teaching veterinary institutions across the country started implementing and started employing inhalational anesthetic maintenance for delicate, complicated, long duration surgical interventions. So as we all know, ruminants tend to hyperventilate during maintenance of anesthesia, and this can be easily overcome when you have a control over the airway that is possible with the inhalational anesthesia, and that could improve oxygenation. So the advantage offered by the inhalational anesthesia can be very well used in ruminant anesthetic maintenance, and it can be routinely practiced. However, the understanding of the mechanics plays a vital role in the successful implementation of any anesthetic protocol. So in India, the teaching veterinary institutions has four types of anesthetic machines, large animal anesthetic machines, and these are all the commonly available machines across the country. So the apprehension arising out of intricacy or complexity of the large animal anesthetic machine can be easily overcome if the concepts of inhalational anesthesia are understood very clearly. So all large animal anesthetic machines are designed on Boyle's apparatus model with some modifications to suit large animal practice. The components of large animal anesthetic machine can be categorized into two broad categories: basic components and a breathing system. So any anesthetic machine warrants oxygen source to run the machine. So in India, all veterinary teaching institutions are using compressed oxygen as their oxygen source, and these cylinders are typically refilled and supplied at a pressure of about 2000 to 2200 PSI. The pressure regulator reduces the cylinder pressure, and oxygen is supplied at a working pressure of 60 psi, which is essentially needed to run large animal anesthetic ventilator. A small malfunction in the pressure regulator could be devastating. So please ensure that the oxygen regulator is functioning properly. the manometer attached to the regulator can read the pressure within the cylinder, and that can be used to assess how much oxygen is available with you. The flesh valve assembly in the large animal anesthetic machine needs to be used to fill the breathing system before you start the procedure. So it will deliver oxygen at a very high flow rate, and easily denitrogenation can be accomplished. The use of flesh valve with patient connected to the breathing system is not advocated, as there will be a very high flow rate causing barotrauma. Coming to the system, mainly because of unidirectional or one way, by the presence of unidirectional valves in the system, as well as the pressure gradient between the inspiratory limb and the expiratory limb. The adjustable pressure limiting valve, commonly called as pop-off valve, is used to prevent pressure buildup within the breathing system and to prevent the pressure-induced barotrauma in the lungs. And all anesthetic machine will have a manometer to record the pressure changes that is happening in the airway. The oxygen flow rate, APL valve, and vaporizer setting are the three crucial things that has to be operated to maintain anesthesia in large animals. So this is a simple illustration to depict the gas flow. So once you open the oxygen cylinder, the cylinder releases the oxygen, and pressure regulator reduces the pressure from 2000 psi to 60 psi, and it goes to the flow meter, and it goes through the vaporizer, and oxygen anesthetic gas mixture is formed, and it is being delivered to the circle. So it takes the inspiratory limb and it goes to the patient, and the air exhaled from the patient takes up the expiratory limb, and the carbon dioxide, yes Divesh,
sir, Divesh? there is a little bit of echo from your side, sir, maybe the room. And sir, if you can move that bar, hide or stop sharing from the bottom. Okay. Yes sir. Yes, sir.
So,
yes. Yeah. Thank you.
The air will contain CO2, and this will be absorbed by the CO2 canister, and it will be the again the oxygen anesthetic gas mixture will be rebreathed. Imagine a condition you employ high flow rates. So naturally, the high flow rate will cause pressure buildup within the system that can be easily evidenced by the excessively distended rebreathing back. And if the APL valve is not open, the pressure that has built up in the system will cause barotrauma. So naturally, the APL valve has to be kept open when high flow rates are employed. So coming to the first setting, oxygen flow rate at the rate of 10 mL per kg per minute can be considered as a partial rebreathing system. And it is considered partial rebreathing because the metabolic oxygen demand during anesthesia will be less than that, and naturally there will be only a partial rebreathing can happen. The oxygen flow rate can be reduced to less than 10 ml per kg per minute depending on the requirement, depending on the metabolic oxygen demand of the individual animal, and that can be considered to be a total rebreathing system if the flow rate is set to match the metabolic oxygen demand of that particular animal. So the metabolic oxygen demand of the animal is calculated based on the Brody's formula, and roughly it comes to 3.5 ml per kg per minute. So naturally you need a oxygen flow rate of 3.5 ml per kg per minute. However, there are few reports that states that the metabolic equivalent as calculated with Brody's formula may not be sufficient to meet oxygen demand under certain circumstances. So under such circumstances, the metabolic oxygen requirement can be estimated by the difference in the inspired and entidal oxygen concentration multiplied by minute ventilation. So this can be easily achieved when you have a multi-gas monitor and a spirometer. So we have carried out a study and we have observed that the metabolic oxygen demand varied from 3.5 to a maximum of 7 ml per kg per minute. So naturally, when you use low flow, low oxygen flow rate, the protocol will be more efficient as well as eco-friendly. The oxygen flow rate is the one which determines the economy as well as ecological concern. The more the oxygen flow rate, the more will be the scavenging, the more will be the wastage, and the protocol will be costlier. A global warming gas, a potent greenhouse gas, 1400 times more potent than CO2. So naturally, the protocol you develop or you adapt should minimize scavenging. Unnecessary or unwarranted scavenging of inhalant into the atmosphere should be minimized. And this can be easily achieved by employing low flow technique. One bottle of isoflurane, 250 ml of isoflurane bottle, is equivalent to 525 kg of carbon dioxide, and you need this much 25 trees to utilize this equivalent carbon dioxide. So naturally, the protocol what we are using should be effective and it should be efficient so that the ecological concerns can be minimized. And coming to the APL valve. APL valve is commonly termed as pop-off valve and it is functioning based on the spring-loaded tension. So once when the APL valve is operated, the pressure required to release the gas will be changing, will be influenced. So there are two types of APL valves. One is open to atmosphere, which we commonly see in Indian machines, and second type is open to scavenging system. So you can attach a tube and this can be taken to the scavenging system. And APL valve has to be kept opened or partially opened or closed based on the oxygen flow rate you employ. When increased oxygen flow rate is employed, naturally the APL valve should be kept open. And when you want to give assisted ventilation or when you want to do mechanical ventilation, the APL valve has to be kept closed. And vaporizer setting. So it can be adjusted from 0 to 5% as per the requirement, and very easily the depth of anesthesia can be altered by altering the vaporizer setting during maintenance. So the settings of concern to maintain anesthesia are oxygen flow rate, APL valve function and vaporizer setting. So to recap, oxygen flow rate and APL valve operation are directly related and they go hand in hand. So naturally, when you increase the oxygen flow rate, the APL valve should be kept open. And when you want to do mechanical ventilation or assisted ventilation, the APL valve should be kept closed. And the vaporizer setting can be altered as to the requirement. And second concept is understanding the time constant concept. As we all know, the inspired concentration of inhalant anesthetic is largely dependent on the vaporizer setting. Yes. There is one more equally important factor that influences the inspired concentration of inhalant anesthetic, that is time constant. So the time constant plays a crucial role in large animal inhalational anesthesia because the volume of circle in large animal anesthesia anesthetic machine is considerably high or significantly high compared to the oxygen flow rate we employ. So consider a Mallard machine with ascending bellows with 18 liter bellows capacity and a breathing tube with a water capacity of 7 liters and a soda lime canister of 10 liters. We will be making a volume of say about 30 liters. And the inspired concentration of inhalant anesthetic at any point of time can be calculated based on this calculation. So here is an illustration to demonstrate or to explain how the time constant principle affects the inspired concentration of inhalant agent. Consider a situation wherein you want to achieve an inspired concentration of 1.8% of isoflurane in a cattle with the oxygen flow rate of 5%, 5 liters per minute. So the oxygen will be flowing to the vaporizer and it will be preparing isoflurane oxygen gas mixture and it will be leaving the common gas outlet with the iso concentration of 1.8%. But as the gas mixture enters the circle, it gets diluted and the patient will be inspiring a concentration which is less than what is set in the vaporizer. So this principle has to be understood very clearly and it takes time for the circle to get saturated and only after 30 minutes of saturation, the patient will start inspiring 1.8% of isoflurane what is set in the vaporizer. So naturally, this cannot be acceptable. So generally what we do increase the oxygen flow rate and we will try to saturate the system at the earliest possible time. So when you increase the oxygen flow rate to 10 liters per minute, naturally you can achieve saturation in 15 minutes and after 15 minutes, the patient will start inspiring 1.8% of isoflurane concentration. But this is also, again, not an acceptable thing because you will be scavenging more of oxygen as well as the potent isoflurane into the atmosphere. So what can be done is increasing the setting to the highest setting possible will saturate the circle at the quickest possible time. When you have an oxygen flow rate of 5 liters per minute with evaporation setting of 5%, in 2.68 minutes you can saturate the system and after 3rd minute the patient will start inspiring 1.8% concentration. One point that has to be remembered here is, so it has taken approximately 3 minutes for the circle to get saturated and naturally after 3 minutes of keeping the vaporizer in 5%, it has to be reduced as to the requirement. So when you use high vaporizer setting at the initial phase, naturally you will be decreasing the isoflurane scavenger into the atmosphere, thereby you will be reducing the expenditure incurred on the scavenger isoflurane. Whereas with the lower setting, you will be scavenging more amount of isoflurane into the atmosphere as well as you will be incurring higher cost. So higher vaporizer setting at the start of the procedure will reduce the isoflurane scavenge as well as the cost of isoflurane scavenge. So before you start, make sure that you have a checklist and ensure you have adequate oxygen available because large animal practice may warrant mechanical ventilation at any point of time. Naturally, you need to have adequate oxygen and ensure inhalant in the vaporizer, carry out a leak check test, select endotracheal tube and try to intubate the patient, select appropriate rebreathing bag and check sodalite. So ensuring oxygen availability. So the oxygen availability with your cylinder can be easily calculated by multiplying the water capacity of the cylinder, which is engraved on all the cylinders, multiplied with the pressure reading. So you will have a regulator with a manometer. So the moment you open the oxygen cylinder, the pressure gauge will give you a reading in atmosphere or bar or kilogram per centimeter square. So naturally, you have to just see the pressure reading, multiply the water capacity of the cylinder. You will have how much oxygen you have with you and then you can start the procedure. And opening the oxygen cylinder, many of the time we have a confusion how to open, clockwise or anti-clockwise. Remember your water tap, so anti-clockwise is to open the cylinder. And most of the time we will have little difficulty because the pressure reading may not be in ATM or bar or kilogram per centimeter square. We have different types of manometers across the country. So if you don't have a manometer with kg per centimeter square or ATM, naturally you may have this type of manometer. So whatever the reading you have, multiply the reading with the water capacity divided by 15. So that will give you a oxygen, how much oxygen you have in the cylinder. And commonly we make use of A type cylinder, which is having a water capacity of approximately 4.5 liters, and B type cylinder having a water capacity of 10 liters, and the bulk cylinder which is having a water capacity of approximately 45 liters. You just multiply the water capacity 4.5 into the pressure reading, you will know how much. Imagine if this A type cylinder is having 100 atm pressure, so 100 into 4.5, 450 liters will be there. So maximum it can be pressurized to about only 660 liters. So B type cylinder will have a water capacity of 10 liters and maximum it can have 1400 liters, and G type can have a maximum oxygen of 6000 liters to 6500 liters. And before you start the procedure, ensure that the vaporizers are filled with inhalants, sufficient quantity of inhalants, and don't try to fill the vaporizer during the procedure. And try to do leak check test wherever you suspect leak. Just take your detergent soap, moisten it with your brush, put it over the suspected places where you suspect leak, and if there is bubbling, naturally it indicates that there is a leak. And endotracheal intubation is very, very crucial in anesthetic maintenance of room inhalants. And active regurgitation can happen when there is insufficient induction. So when the induction is insufficient, the palpation and the reflex cast itself will result in active regurgitation. So that is called as active regurgitation. And ruminants tend to have passive regurgitation during deep plane of anesthesia. So intubation has to be done at the quickest possible time with the all available gadgets. And endotracheal tubes should not be lubricated with any lubricant containing local anesthetic, because it is going to abolish the mucous ciliary clearance. Definitely is going to end up with aspiration. So never it should be applied. So selecting the rebreathing bag, so based on 60 ml per kg body weight as a thumb rule, you can breathe. And soda lime exhaustion can happen with large animal anesthetic practice, and especially with long duration surgeries. So the color change will be evident during surgery, and it gives the indication that the soda lime is exhausting, and next day naturally it has to be changed. To recap, ensure adequate oxygen before you start the procedure, and try to fill the vaporizer before you start the procedure, and vaporizer dial setting has to be altered depending on the requirement and depending on the requirement of depth of anesthesia, and understanding the functioning of APL valve. So naturally the APL valve has to be kept open when high flow rates are used, and when assisted ventilation or mechanical ventilation is employed, the APL valve has to be kept closed. And always try to carry out a leak check test routinely, so that your airway will be airtight. And coming to dose, rotor type of floats should be read from the top, and ball type should be read from the center. This is a common mistake the students do. So rotor type floats should be read from the top. The reading corresponding to the top margin of the rotor should be taken as the oxygen flow rate. And for the ball, it should be the reading corresponding from the center should be taken as the oxygen flow rate. Oxygen valve to be kept open. You can see the rebreathing bag is getting distended. So this will cause pressure buildup in the circle, and that will be reflected onto the patient lung. Sometimes the patient may experience barotrauma. So always keep the APL valve open when high fresh gas flow rate is employed. When you want to assist ventilation, naturally the APL valve has to be kept closed, so that you can deliberately increase the airway pressure and you can deliver the tidal volume. Coming to dose, don't apply petroleum lubricants, and there is always a risk of explosion. So only water based lubricants can come in contact with the machine parts. And don't over tighten the flow regulating valve, because it has a delicate knob that may get damaged. For a successful outcome, so pre-anesthetic preparation plays a vital role. So withholding the food for 24 hours and water withholding for 12 hours will be sufficient, so that you can do intubation at the quickest possible time. When starvation is longer than 24 hours, naturally the liquidity of the room and contents is going to increase. Sometimes you may encounter the fluid coming out. So the fluid will be gushing out. So that can be avoided, and there is no recommendation that the animal should be starved more than 24 hours. And always try to do endotracheal intubation to prevent the regurgitated material getting aspirated into the trachea. So avoiding aspiration. So try to have gag and try to intubate the patient at the quickest possible time with head extended. And hypersalivation management, use of anticholinergics is not indicated as it is going to make the salivary secretion more viscid, and that itself may sometimes cause airway blockage. And anticholinergic will reduce the mucociliary clearance, and sometimes the subacute infection may get exacerbated. And tympani, again, pre-anesthetic fasting will reduce tympani development during maintenance or during anesthesia, and the decreased venous return, compromise on the cardiovascular system, compromise on the respiratory system can be prevented by preventing tympani by proper preoperative preparation. And ruminants tend to have rapid, shallow pattern of breathing. So they will have significant amount of airway resistance, and mechanical ventilation is required or warranted if significant hypoventilation is noticed. So ruminants tend to have a very small tidal volume of say about 3 to 5 ml of tidal volume per kg. So if you are anesthetizing a 300 kg cattle, you will see the bellows are moving from 0 to 1. That means they will be having a tidal volume of just 1 liter. And this can be quantitatively measured if you have a spirometer attached to the Y piece. So when spirometer is connected, you can have the quantitative data of tidal volume that is being taken up by the patient, as well as the respiratory rate and the minute volume. Since they have rapid shallow pattern of breathing, deep sighs are not warranted. So the peak inspiratory pressure at any point of time should not exceed 30 cm of water. And peak inspiratory pressure should be at 15 to 20 cm of water to meet majority of the demands. And the patient may develop hypotension, and if the mean arterial pressure goes below 70, naturally it has to be intervened. So inotropes can be used, IV fluids can be used, calcium administration can be done to reverse the hypotension. And large dose of xylazine and azithromycin in the anesthetic protocol is definitely going to cause significant hypotension, and all inhalants are potent hypotensive agent. Definitely very deep planes of anesthesia achieved with inhalants will cause significant hypotension. So that has to be reversed or that has to be intervened. So patient put on lateral recumbency for a prolonged period of time can develop radial nerve paralysis like syndrome. So proper positioning, padding the dependent shoulder with an inflated rubber tube and supporting the upper limb with a padded foam can prevent neuropathy in the post-anesthetic period. And providing soft bedding in the post-anesthetic period can help the patient to recover from the problem. So economics calculation, if you are using a judicial oxygen flow rate of 10 ml per kg per minute or a cattle weighing 300 kg with a fresh gas flow rate of 3 liters per minute, and if your duration of maintenance is going to extend for 60 minutes for 1 hour with a vaporized rating of 2%, the economics will be rupees 180 per hour. So this economics was calculated assuming the cost of isoflurane as rupees 2500 per bottle, 250 ml bottle. So assuming 1 ml of isoflurane as rupees 10, we have derived, and you can definitely achieve anesthesia. The protocol can be safe as well as it can be economically viable. So coming to large animal ventilators, so the large animal anesthetic machines available in India are divided into two categories: machines with ascending type of bellows and machines with descending type of bellows. The Malad is having ascending type, and all other machines, Surgivet, the Titan GRE, the Wetland machine are with descending type bellows. So ascending type bellow will ascend during expiration, and due to the gravity, they will exert positive end expiratory pressure of say about 3 to 3.5 centimeter of water. So this peak caused by the bellows of the ventilator will keep the lungs opened up. So the collapse of alveoli will not happen if you make use of the ventilator bellows as rebreathing bag during maintenance of anesthesia in patients who are having spontaneous ventilation. So remember, AAE, ascending type will have a bellows that ascends during expiration, whereas the descending type of ventilators will descend during expiration, and the descending type of ventilators will not create peak at the end of expiration. So anesthesia ventilator are very simple. They just replace the rebreathing bag of the breathing circuit in a anesthetic machine. It is basically composed of a distensible bellow and a rigid housing. So the anesthetic gas, inhalant gas mixture goes into the bellow, and it is an exclusive circuit. It doesn't communicate with the driving gas, and driving gas doesn't come in contact with the anesthetic gas mixture. So the anesthetic gas mixture present within the bellows will be inspired by the patient, and the expired air may come to the bellows. The driving gas enters the outer chamber, and this driving gas is pushed into the chamber to compress the bellows of the ventilator. So the driving gas enters the outer housing, and it tries to compress the bellows so that the airway pressure in the breathing system increases and the patient is made to inspire. So the driving gas will be compressing the bellows, and the gas will be delivered to the patient. At the end of its inspiration, the driving gas will be scavenged to the atmosphere, and expiration will start on its own. So one important point that has to be remembered here is, on an average, 1.3 to 1.5 liters of driving gas would be required to push the bellows assembly to deliver a 1 liter of tidal volume. So consider a situation wherein you start mechanical ventilation in a 400 kg cattle with a tidal volume setting of 4 liters and a respiratory rate of 10 breaths per minute. And if you want to do mechanical ventilation for a duration of 30 minutes, you require, or you definitely require, 1800 liters of driving gas, that is oxygen. All anesthetic machines available in India are oxygen driven. So when you want to do mechanical ventilation, ensure that you have adequate oxygen supply for driving gas. So every breath it will be utilizing 1.5 liters to push 1 liter of tidal volume. And if you are setting tidal volume of 4 liters, naturally for every breath you will be scavenging 6 liters of oxygen. And if it is for 10 respiratory rate per minute, naturally every minute you will be wasting 60 liters, or 60 liters of oxygen will be scavenged to the atmosphere. And if it is for 1 hour duration, naturally you require 3600 liters of oxygen to be available for the driving gas. So you cannot do mechanical ventilation with V-type cylinder. You need a refilled bulk cylinder to perform mechanical ventilation in a cattle weighing 400 kg because you require 1800 liters of oxygen just to drive the bellows. So naturally you have to do that. And when you are provided with a ascending type of ventilators, keep the bellows always distant and when not in use to avoid collapse and damage to the bellows. And the rapid shallow breathing pattern of cattle naturally makes the animal prone for deep sighs. That means if you are doing mechanical ventilation with higher peak inspiratory pressure setting, naturally it is going to cause alveolar damage. So coming to the conclusion, the components of large animal anesthetic machine are similar to small animal anesthetic machine and can be used just like a small animal anesthetic machine. Employing low flow techniques and understanding the time constant principle will lessen the amount of inherent scavenge, making the protocol economically viable as well as eco-friendly. Adequate availability of oxygen for large animal inhalation anesthesia should be ensured before the start of the procedure. And inhalational maintenance in large animals will offer the best possible comfort for the patient as well as the surgeon. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Participants, if you have any queries, feel free to ask. Sir will address your queries if you have any. Sir, we have a question, Sandil sir.
So the most economical inhalant will be, the protocol will be economical only when you select the appropriate oxygen fluoride. So you don't require the oxygen fluoride more than 10 mL per kg per minute. Generally we improve with 10 mL per kg per minute. So that will be most economical for ruminant practice. Which gas is used as driving gas? In India, all anesthetic machines are oxygen driven, and the oxygen is used as the driving gas. We don't use medical gas for driving the bellows. Thank you, Bala.
Yes, sir.
Is there any difference between cattle and buffalo in anesthesia?
To my knowledge, there is no difference, sir. Buffaloes are almost on par. They could do with whatever available pre-medications and protocol. So buffaloes are almost similar, sir. Except for intubation, we don't find any difference in inhalational anesthesia.
Okay. Because Raj Bohat has told that you are the first person to work on buffaloes. That's why I asked.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Deepak Sutar, endotracheal intubation is easy in equines because naturally in equines, just if you pass the endotracheal tube, naturally it will enter into the trachea. Whereas in case of cattle, you have to apply mouth gag and you have to take the tube and manually you have to intubate it. The larynx has to be opened, the alternate has to be manipulated to push the tube into the trachea. Any contraindications for inhalation anesthesia in large animals? Yes, they tend to hypoventilate and they are potent hypotensive agent. So wherever you don't require hypotension, naturally you have to avoid inhalation agent, or it should be used with the minimal quantity. And maybe you can think of combining CRI with opioids and ketamine or lignocaine. Scavenging system, to my knowledge, no veterinary institutions in India is using scavenging system for large animal practice. So just we are taking the gas outside the theater to avoid polluting the theater. time constant, I have explained, yes, what will happen if you... Inhalant should... That is a protocol. Sometimes accidentally you may spill the inhalant into the breathing system and suddenly there will be vaporization resulting in unsafe concentration. That is why, as a precaution, always ensure that the vaporizers are refilled before you start the procedure. How to select ET? ET is available from 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 22, 24. So according to the size, you can select, and from 16 it is cuffed, and below that it is non-cuffed. And some companies supply cuffed endotracheal tube with a less diameter. So accordingly you can select. Induction agent, we generally prefer double dead. Glycerin guaifenate and ketamine is found to be very safe combination. And other drugs can also be used. Diazepam ketamine can also be used in case of cattle as an induction agent. Pre-anesthetic agent, GG ketamine will be used as an induction agent. How can I calculate the driving gas? So that is, Srikanta, I will get back to you, because that is a calculation. You have to do it manually, and we have calculated. So that that is out of the subject here. Pre-medical, yes, Mr. Vagalet is ideal. Diazepam can be used, midazolam can be used, butorphanol can be used. Buprenorphine, sometimes they cause excitement during the recovery phase. That's in emergency kit for large animal anesthesia. Calcium, the respiratory stimulant, dobutamine. If the hypotension is very significant, naturally you can think of dobutamine. Atropine is not used in ruminants, yes, because it is going to make the salivary secretion more viscid, and actually it may cause the airway blockage, and it is going to definitely cause or decrease the mucociliary clearance. It may end up with aspiration complications. Precautionary measure during regurgitation. So, Celix maneuver, if you are finding difficulty, just push the esophagus over trachea and try to close the esophagus so that the regurgitated material don't get aspirated. And the second thing is, don't waste time in trying to intubate. Just pass the tube, definitely it will go into the esophagus and you will be diverting all the regurgitated material outside. And once the regurgitation episode stops, take out the rebreathing, endotracheal tube, clear it, then again go for the attempt. Can we do induction using isoflurane directly? No. Is any inhalant anesthesia other than isoflurane for ruminants? Halothane can be used. Now everybody is using isoflurane, and now some institutes, they started even sevoflurane. Procedure for endotracheal intubation in bovine. Yeah, you need to have a mouth gag. What is the mouth gag? Keep the mouth opened, pass your hand into the oral cavity, try to palpate the larynx, try to open up the arachnoids, and push the endotracheal tube into the trachea. How to manage regurgitation if occurs during? That is what I have explained. Try to don't waste time in attempting, just pass the tube into the esophagus, divert all the regurgitated material outside, avoid aspiration, and then Cypromycin glycopyrrolate is not used in ruminants, to my knowledge. Maybe it is used in small animals, but we are not using it. No, lateral recumbency depends on the surgical requirement. Surgical position is as per the surgical requirement. So, as Suryadas was mentioning, yeah, small animal machine can be used with modification because they are luminous. So, the tidal volume during spontaneous ventilation will be, say, about 1 to 1.5 liters, And if you are having a rebreathing bag of 10 liters or 6 liters bag, definitely you can maintain anesthesia with small animal anesthetic machine. The airway resistance will be there. That is an inherent drawback, inherent limitation that cannot be overcome, but still it can be used and it can be maintained. For clinical cases, the anesthetic combination better for intubation and smooth anesthesia is, yes, to my knowledge, glycerin glycolate ketamine combination is suitable for all patients, even compromised patients. They will be safe and you can do intubation very easily. Tips on do's and don'ts in recovery period. So during recovery period, you have to provide non-slippery flooring. That is one essential thing that has to be done. And you have to allow the animal to get up on its own. So don't be in a hurry, don't try to make the animal onto food, because they comfortably get up. The ET tube application, yes, we have, but because of time, we have been given only 45 minutes, so they have a next program. So we will continue. To avoid aspiration, we need to remove inflated tube. Yes, yes, yes. Without deflating, you have to remove so that the aspirated contents will be taken out. Anesthetic combination recommended for different surgeries in ruminants. That you have to decide. According to the requirements, it has to be decided.
Sanjay. Give your email address. If anybody wants additional information, let them contact by email, yes, and you can personally contact him.
Okay, sir.
Take some water. I think you are feeling thirsty. Thank you. Thank you for your nice presentation. Thank you, sir.
Dr. Sendil, Surya Das.
Yes,
excellent, excellent presentation. Congratulations. And we feel that you are a little exhausted. Please take some breath and take some water.
Yeah, because we wanted to finish before 5, so they have one more program. Yes, lidocaine CRI required in ketamine diazepam CRI combination. Yes, sir. Lidocaine can be used. Lidocaine CRI can be used, and even opiates can be combined. Butorphanol is drug of choice, can be combined. How much time animals require to recover? In 20 to 30 minutes, they will come to sternal recumbency from the time of discontinuation of inhalant. Definitely all, especially with ISO, definitely in 30 minutes, they will come to sternal recumbency, and it may take another half an hour to 1 hour to get onto the food. Anesthetic emergency during inhalation anesthesia is just hypotension, typically hypotension, hypoventilation. So all machines are having a ventilator facility. So naturally you can think of mechanical ventilation or assisted ventilation. Thank you, sir. Ayyappan, sir. Divesh, they were asking for the endotracheal intubation video. Shall I share it?
Yeah, please.
Yes,
Divesh.
Sir. Yes, sir. Divesh, I it. Santil, sir.
Yeah.
Please, sir.
So you have to extend the neck, apply a mouth gag, try to take the endotracheal tube into the oral cavity, palpate the larynx and try to push the endotracheal tube after opening the arytenoid cartilage. And you can check, you can ask someone to put a pressure on the thorax, and you can definitely hear the expired air coming out of the tube. So this is a very simple thing, so that can be done. You need a gag and endotracheal tube. That's all.
Sir, are you sharing video, sir?
Yeah. But the streaming, I think I'm having a little bit difficulty.
Dr. Tiwari.
Yes, sir.
If there are no questions, you can conclude.
Okay, sir is trying to stream some video, sir.
Okay, you can wind up.
Okay, sir. So, I extend my deepest thanks to Dr. Senthil Kumar, sir, Associate Professor and Head, Veterinary Clinical Complex, Veterinary College and Research Institute, Ornithatru, for delivering the webinar on such a clinically important and interesting topic and sharing his experiences in the ruminant airline anesthesia. I am also thankful to my team members, Dr. Nilesh Sindhu, webinar moderator, and Mr. Sahil, who worked hard to organize this webinar. I am thankful to all the participants who spared time and upgrading their skills in anesthesia. Thank you to all who directly and indirectly supported us to make this webinar a success. We will go with the series of the webinar and very soon we will let you know the next topic and the speaker. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I thank all my teachers for the blessings they have showered on me to make this presentation a successful one. Thank